As we think about all of this, I want you to think about what it was like to be a kid for a minute. And I actually know everyone's still there. You still think you're like 12 years old, maybe 16. But I just want you to think for a moment what it was like when you were a kid out in nature. And I want you to think about a time when you were out in nature, and it could have been just your backyard or just a pile of dirt somewhere in a construction site or just something outside, maybe with a friend or by yourself. And I want you to think about that. I want you to picture it in your mind right now. And I want you to go back there. And I want to just spend a couple seconds here and have you think about that quietly and just sort of picture that whole scene and focus especially on how you felt. So let's do that now. What we're doing right now is we're doing an essential part of being a canyoneer with people. People don't really care how much you know unless they know how much you care. And a lot of the information that we have in our heads, we're so excited we want to share it. You'd be surprised how much people already know. And so really your primary mission out there is not to communicate all this wealth of knowledge, because they're going to forget it next week anyway. What they're not going to forget is how you made them feel out there and how enthusiastic you are about seeing something you didn't anticipate. And I think it's really an essential ingredient to the teaching component of Canyoneers is that, you know, your mission is really to not show people how smart you are, but how smart they are. And all of a sudden, they don't want to end the trip. And you know this. I mean, it's a classic Dale Carnegie thing where, you know, the greatest word, most important word most people hear in a conversation is their own name. So it's the same thing. Nothing's changed. And so you really want to endeavor to engage and bring people into the trail experience. And it'll be a much more rewarding thing. And sometimes it's a little awkward at first, especially if you're already a introvert yourself, because some people won't participate and you just kind of have to bear the pregnant silences, kind of like what we did here at first, because nobody really wanted to be the first one, right? But once it starts rolling, it's a lot more fun and it takes the pressure off of you too. So that's just sort of a key point I want to bring up at the very beginning. So I want to sort of share with you a data set that I put together in a slide. And what I've got here is time is on the horizontal axis and time outdoors is on the vertical axis. And we did a pretty good job being outdoors most of the time as a species until about 2.5 million years ago. And that's when we started picking up rocks and making tools. And that sort of separated us from the other animals in a way that was gonna ultimately end up where we are today. Fire was the next big thing. We were able to access caves and exploit the environment in a way that no other animal is able to. Darkness wasn't the defining quality of safety anymore. And then agriculture about 10,000 years ago really started ramping up the let's be indoors phenomena. And then as you can see down the graph, all sorts of things start happening. And cars is a big deal here. You know, we have highways and freeways that sort of keep us from being able to really connect with anything other than our own little bubble where we live and where we work, right? So we don't get to drive through some places we don't really want to drive through and places we wouldn't normally anyway, even if we wanted to. And I'll give you an example. My car needed a new tire. So I didn't know nobody was around to help me. So I took the car down there and I walked home. It was about a mile and a half. And the smells and the sounds of the town I live in, I'd never experienced before. And it was really a strange phenomenon to actually be outdoors smelling things that I wasn't familiar with. So the whole concept of being outdoors is really important. And I know you've probably heard this 1,000 times, but there's a lot of science behind this. It isn't just, oh, let's be cool and be outdoors. It's a health issue. And I'll explain that in a minute. the consequences of what we do most of the time are pretty severe. So there's higher cortisol levels. That's a hormone that comes out of the back of your adrenals on top of your kidneys. It's an important hormone that gets you ready for fight or flight. But with all the surrounding noises and things we have, freeways, you may think you're shutting those things out, but they're constantly bombarding your mind. And so unnatural noises that are not normally found in the wilderness, they cause cortisol levels to rise. And that consequently creates stress for your body, which initiates a lot of pathological conditions like cancer and things like that. We're more irritable, we're more distracted, our brains don't work as well. And so we respond to these things with all sorts of neurotic behaviors, compulsive reactions. Narcissism is a big one. Self-medication. I don't mind doing that myself from time to time, but we have to realize why we're doing it. That's the important thing. And a lot of this is a result of being indoors. So what's the solution? Well, you probably already know, and that's to be outdoors, right? And I want to emphasize this a little bit in that it isn't just being in a wilderness area or being on a trail. It's just seeing green. There was a doctor, I think in New Jersey in the 80s, he did a research project where he wanted to find out, he was a gallbladder doctor, whether his patients recovered better on the side of the hospital where the windows faced the hospital building next to them, or on the other side where it faced a park. And what he found was that the people who faced the park, the nurses liked them better, they got out of the hospital faster, and they asked for less pain medication. So we don't know exactly what's going on, but it's almost just seeing green. And from that study is why if you go to your dentist or doctor's office, they invariably have some wilderness scene or pictures of waterfalls in the office. And that's because it calms you down. It makes you feel good. And why is that? Because you're home again. You're not in a cubicle anymore, an artificial space. And you're sensing the places where you once were and where you evolved for millions of years. So we're still hardwired. We've only been doing this indoor thing for at the most 10,000 years. So being a canyoneer and getting people outdoors, share this information with them, because it isn't just, urban myths or sort of like trite information to be outside and how important it is. It's about your health. And there's three things I want you to remember when you're out on the trail and communicating with people and to get the benefits of all that you're going to share is, first of all, being outdoors. That's the most essential thing. And then the sense that you're outdoors, know that you know, and you're probably well aware of the aspect of placebos and all of that when you think you're going to get well and you actually do. When you know you're outdoors and you know it's doing good for you, you know what happens? Your cortisol levels get reduced even more than they would be if you're just outdoors. Your heart rate goes down, your blood pressure goes down, your killer T cell count, which is the immune system component of your body, goes up. And it's different between people who are just outdoors and people who know they're outdoors and it's good for them. So there's that component. And then you wanna connect with the landscape. And this is the important part of the facts that you're gonna learn in canyoneers. You know, it's okay to kind of just, I guess, know there's green. But when you know that green is composed of individuals with names, Ceanothus, Manzanita, Haplopappus, Chamise, Scolophorus occidentalis, it's like going into a party and you know everybody. I've been to parties lots of times, especially when I go to my wife's work parties. I don't know anybody. And I usually end up in the bathroom reading a book. But I remember this one time I was a trained firefighter and I did that for a while. And there was a firefighter in the corner at this one party, and I went right to him. And why was that? Because he was familiar. So when you go outdoors and you know some of these names of these plants and animals, it makes your experience so much more rewarding. And that's something that people kind of pick up on pretty quickly. And you also want to engage, and that goes back to what I said earlier. You just don't want to talk at people. Because frankly, you just ought to stay home and watch a documentary if you're going to do that. You've got to get them engaged. Ask them questions. And I'll give you an example. So Manzanita, you probably know the name of that, right? Or what it means, rather, in Spanish. I won't tell you right now. But instead of saying what it means in Spanish to people, because it's a fun little factoid, You have kids go up to the manzanita plant. If there's berries there, say, take a look at these berries. Does that remind you of any fruit that you're familiar with? And, you know, they may fumble around a little bit, and somebody invariably is going to say, like, a little apple. And you go, that's right. You're so smart. It's little apple in Spanish. So you tease things out of people and you make them feel smart. And all of a sudden, they kind of like you. And that's what this is all about, because nobody listens to anybody they don't like, right? You probably learned that with all the political discussions you've had over the years. So it's all about connecting with people on a personal level. So there's science behind this, lots of data, sound. When you hear birds, water, wind, cortisol levels go down, heart rates go down. Fragrances, there's terpenes, especially in our favorite plants like the sages, laurel, sumacs. Terpenes are what you smell. When you smell those things, guess what happens? Your cortisol levels go down, your heart rate goes down. So all these wonderful things happen. And then visual. When you see this scene that's on the screen right now, it's different than the scene you see in Los Angeles or San Diego. And this is why. This thing that you see, this is a Xylococcus bicolor. It's Mission Manzanita. It's one of the biggest ones I've ever seen. It's in Tin Mine Canyon up near Corona. The biggest one I've ever seen in my life actually, unfortunately, burned. It was the Mission Trails. It's coming back wonderfully now, but it was tragic to see that thing go. But what you're looking at here, if you look at the picture, you'll see there's little branches, and then each branch branches again and again and again. That pattern are called fractals, and fractals are sort of self-repeating patterns. It feels good to see that. You don't even know it's happening to you, but you just look at this and it's a pretty picture. But that's not what's really grabbing you. What's grabbing you is the fractals, and that's what you evolved seeing for millions of years. You didn't evolve seeing windows and doors and straight walls. This is what you know, and this is your home, and that's why it makes you feel good. This is what we call a legacy manzanita. Big old trunks. These trunks are probably 100, 125 years old. And the burl underground here is probably on the order of 1,000 or more years. So we're full sensory beings. And when you take people out on the trail, just remember that. Try to access their different senses, their touch, their smells. Makes things a lot more fun. So there's a lot of science behind all of this. I mentioned some of that with the gallbladder doctor. But, you know, 2 hours outdoors, for example, it's showing a 40% increase in killer T cells. Just an amazing thing. Visual, when you see things, you get much healthier. Wilderness, one of the most key components that have been successful for PTSD sufferers, everything from vets to women who have been abused to kids who've, you know, been abused. You go outdoors and there's this 3-day effect, it's called. There's a woman, I forget, Florence, I forget, but her book is called the 3-day effect. No, the nature fix. You really ought to pick it up, because she documents all of this positive impact on people when they go out in the wilderness. And it takes 3 days for people to actually have that get into their system. And you probably know this. Weekends just don't cut it. If you're somewhere after 3 days, all of a sudden you're kind of getting bored and antsy. And then the fourth day, all of a sudden magical things start happening. So it even doubles that process out in the wilderness. So all of these issues kind of bring up the importance of non-conscious time. In other words, time when you can be bored. I mean, right now what happens? You can't even be bored going out to dinner. Your date goes to the bathroom. What's the usual response? You should go next time you go out to a restaurant and there's a couple and one of them goes to the bathroom. You know what happens with the other person? They check their cell phone, right? We don't have a chance to be bored anymore. That's when the most creative things used to happen. So you want to form connections out there. There's lots of environments, emission trails. We don't have any big Jeffrey pine forest, but we do have oak woodlands and grasslands. That's a riparian area. We don't have a beach. That's our chief spiritual officer for the Chaparral Institute, by the way. That's Cooper on the left. And then there's estuaries. So whatever area is near your house, that's the thing that you really want to form a connection with. Know some of the players out there and see who's kind of roaming around. And I like to throw up a couple little advertisements here for things you're going to be talking about in Canyoneers that sometimes people don't resonate with. One has to do with watersheds. And watersheds have to do with a lot of physical and biological dynamics. But basically, when a raindrop falls in a certain place, if all those raindrops go into one particular river, that's the total watershed. And you can see the Mississippi River's watershed. It's huge. It's that pink one there. And take a look at California, though. Look at Southern California. Look how many watersheds there are. I'll magnify that for you. It's incredible. I mean, there's more watersheds here than anywhere else in the United States. So that helps you understand why Southern California has some of the most diverse, wonderful numbers of species and plants and birds anywhere in the United States. I mean, just look at that. We used to have a lot of estuaries along the coast. We've saved portions of most of them, but those places are very important.
Yeah, you want to keep and protect chaparral.
It's really an important watershed, which a lot of people aren't sure what that means. That's where you keep the water in the backyard or something. But watershed is where the raindrops fall, hits the foliage, percolates slowly into the groundwater, and it prevents erosion. And without chaparral, we'd have a serious water problem as well as an erosional problem.
All right, we're getting ready to really hit the road because you've got three or four locations
right
for us. We're not going to spend the whole day here on the side of Interstate 8, are we?
No,
pretty here, but
yes,
you've got other places for
lots
us to
places
go as
absolutely
well. Okay, our chaparral adventure continues.
This is a map of geology near where I live, and all these different colors represent different rocks. And you don't have to, you know, figure all this out to know that this is really interesting. And again, Southern California has such complex geology. It has to do with all of our dynamics, which then breed actually a lot of biodiversity. In fact, it took them the longest time to come up with a roadside book of geology for Southern California. They finally got one, but it's so complex. So again, the rocks really tell a story, and it's really important to understand the rocks because the rocks will help you understand what kind of plant community is going to be there. Okay, so there's three basic terrestrial ecosystems. We all know what forests are. There's lots of kinds of forests. There's dense forests, there's not so dense forests. And there's grasslands, and there's different kinds of grasslands, and some of them have a lot of flowers. We know about these two things. And it's mainly economic, because that's where we make money. Timber, grazing, cattle, that kind of thing. But there's this ecosystem in between that nobody knows much about. And it's shrublands. And the favorite shrubland that I'm aware of in California is the chaparral, 1P2Rs. And that's what we're going to spend most of our time talking about right now. So chaparral is a unique plant community. It's characterized by a few things, drought hardy shrubs, a Mediterranean type climate, and infrequent wildfire. More on that in a minute. Those are the three key things. And you can actually probably get those three answers from most people when you're out in the chaparral. How would you describe chaparral to a friend? And have them, you know, give it a try. This map over here on the left shows where all the chaparral is in California. It's in every single county in the state except Sacramento, and it used to be there. So it's really should be the state ecosystem, right? And fortunately, there's four big preserves in Southern California that have protected it. And those are national forests, but there's a problem with that because the name isn't appropriate, right? It's like, it's not a forest. So we're going to get rid of that name, and we're going to ask ourselves, what's a better name for these landscapes? Because when you go up there to the Cleveland National Forest, what are you looking for? You're looking for a forest. And so if things are misnamed, you miss the things that should be named appropriately. So we want to change the name of this to National Chaparral Preserves. that would cause people to actually go there and look for chaparral. I know there's some trees in the Cleveland National Forest. There's some trees and mission trails, but for the most part, it's chaparral and other native shrublands like sage scrub. So why chaparral and not trees? Why is there so much chaparral in California? Well, take a look at the rain graph here, and you'll notice as you go up the state, there's more rain. As you go across the year, the rain increases in the winter, and then it drops down in the summer, which is really weird. Most places in the world, the rain falls in the summer. So that's what the Mediterranean climate is. Hot, dry summers and mild, wet winters. And there's five of these places in the world. California, Mediterranean, which it's named for, Central Chile, South Africa, and Southwestern Australia. So again, chaparral and Mediterranean climates have tremendous diversity because they're edge climates, they're edge habitats. They have a lot of diversity because they have a lot of edges. And what that means is they're on the edge of destruction and survival. And that kind of thing creates a lot of creativity. And it's no surprise to me whatsoever that the greatest civilizations on Earth, in Western civilization anyway, happened in Mediterranean climates. And I'm speaking, of course, of Rome. So this weird climate situation where it's so dry in the summer creates these strange patterns on hillsides. And I know you've seen these. North-facing slopes, you get chaparral. And on south-facing slopes, you get less dense chaparral or sage scrub. Both of them get the same amount of rainfall, but one's facing the sun more than the other, right? So this is really weird because in most places, you never see this kind of dichotomy. There's enough water, but all it takes is a little change in where you're facing will create a whole new different habitat. You know, you do a 360 spin in Wisconsin and all you see is Wisconsin. You do that here, you can see a half a dozen habitats because of these different orientations. Is anybody from Wisconsin? So are there seasons in the chaparral? Well, sure. You know, we're sort of brainwashed into thinking this sort of pattern, April showers being May flowers. Well, that's more about, you know, I'll just stick with the Wisconsin theme here when we came from Wisconsin. So we're going to ditch that and make it more appropriate to our area. I made this up. Winter rainy days bring February bouquets. So when everybody back east is shoveling snow, we're entering our spring. So that's really the theme here. And most people don't know this. They just know it's sunny all the time. Well, when is it sunny? So there you have it. And what's interesting is most of the plants will bloom in January and February, especially the manzanitas. So they have what we call nascent inflorescences. And inflorescence is just a scientific name for flowers. And nascent is sort of like sort of ready, but not quite done yet. And you can look at the manzanitas and the ceanothus shrubs right now. And they all have little buds that were formed last spring. And they're just hanging out for the summer and they're going to pop and be ready to go in January. So how is chaparral diverse? Now, if you haven't noticed, I'm asking questions here. So the first question was why no trees? So you should know it's about the climate. And how is chaparral diverse? Well, there's a whole bunch of different kinds. It's not all the same. And I've come up with 11 main types. And I don't have my handy dandy book box here today, but I just so happen to have a copy of this phenomenal book where this characterization is all described. So if I go too fast, you can go to our website and pick up a copy, or you can join the Institute and you get one for free. How's that for a sales job? So take a look at these numbers here. And what do we see? What the first six, what are they characterized by? The first categorizations there. What do you notice? They're all names of what? Plants. So all of those, chemise chaparral, what do you think you find in chemise chaparral? Chemise. The next four are geographic. And the last one is basically because of the soil. And serpentine, if you didn't know, is California's state rock. And it's sort of a greeny, shiny thing. It's actually quite pretty. And serpentine soils are really, really, what do you call it? Depauperate. They don't have a lot of nutrients. They actually have a lot of toxins in them. So this is maritime chaparral. And maritime chaparral, sort of the definition is, if you're standing in chaparral and you can see the ocean, it's maritime chaparral. Point Loma, the Torrey Pines Reserve, that's really classic maritime chaparral. This is ceanothus chaparral. Got a lot of ceanothus chaparral in Mission Trails and in other areas in the county. In the background, you have chenille chaparral. In the foreground, you have redshank chaparral. This is out off of Sunrise Highway out near Alpine. And there's chenille chaparral in the fall, sometimes summer, depending on the altitude. It's got these really beautiful brown auburn dead flower clusters that form. And then there's manzanita chaparral, the museum where I think the canyoneers first started. A lot of the manzanita there isn't traditional manzanita. It's Xylococcus bicolor. It's the mission manzanita. So they don't get quite this big, but they've got the red bark. So this fellow here is probably about 130 years old, not the guy on the left, but the plant. This is Ione chaparral. It's a very unique kind. It's south of Sacramento. It occupies a space of about two miles by 7 miles long. And it's got this fun little low-growing manzanita. It's called Ione manzanita. And here's one of my favorite types of chaparral. This is island chaparral. This is on Santa Rosa. And I don't think the canyoneers do a trip out there, but before you can't do it anymore, you need to go to Santa Cruz, Santa Rosa Island, and go up on the Torrey Pine Trail. And there's this formation of chaparral that's amazing. The Torrey Pines here are shorter and stockier than we have at Torrey Pines Natural Preserve in Del Mar or San Diego, I guess. Okay, let's talk about the animals. This is a wren tit. That's a W-R-E-N-T-I-T. The wren tit is a characteristic bird of the chaparral. They live about 10 years, and their territory is about an acre, acre and a half. And they're usually the first bird you hear in the chaparral in the morning and the last one you hear at dusk. So they're wonderful little birds. There's a paper by Mary Erickson. It's online, and you can get a copy of it. It's actually a PhD that she sort of synthesized. And it talks about the wren tit in ways that you just can't find anymore. It was back in the day when scientists, it was okay to be emotional. It's a wonderful paper, Mary Erickson. So let's look at some of the birds. Spotted towhee. You should run into him from time to time. This is another wren, but it's not a wren tit. It's a Buick's wren. It's got that little eyebrow. You can see it. They sound like song sparrows. They on steroids. They kind of go, and they do this little rattle thing. It's really kind of fun. And you know this one. This is the scrub jay. Now, when you ask people the name of this bird, what do you think the name of the bird is? Be careful with that. They'll say blue jay. Well, that's not it. It's a scrub jay. And this reminds me of an important point. Don't ask questions people can't answer, because you're invariably going to embarrass them and make them feel stupid. And that's not your job, right? So you want to ask them things they can answer and make it easy and guide them to it. Never say, no, it's not a blue jay, it's a scrub jay. I used to do this myself. It doesn't work very well. People stop listening. There's an Allen's hummingbird. Lots of hummingbirds out in the chaparral. This is the one that has a kind of really high-pitched squeak. Roadrunners, of course, and our famous acorn woodpecker. And there's a lot of arthropods. This is a ceanothus silk moth. It's larval food, its caterpillar food is surprisingly the ceanothus, which is a famous chaparral shrub, which you'll learn about. Look at those antennas. Is this a male or a female? Think about it. So the males have to find the females. The males are the showy ones, right? So that's a male with those foofy antennas, which are designed to pick up the tiny molecules in the air that the female's releasing, her pheromones that she's releasing for him to find her. Then, of course, we have the California grizzly bear. It's on the state flag. It was the dominant animal in the chaparral, not the forest. This was a chaparral animal. And here's the last one that was killed in 1908 in Southern California. It was up Holy Jim Canyon, which is a sort of a side branch from Chubuco Canyon in the Santa Ana Mountains. We don't know much about this bear because a lot of the people who cared about it enough to study it, they were gone by the time anybody was able to pick up a pencil and an observation notebook. If you want to see a book or read a book that's really the definitive book on grizzly bears, this is it. California Grizzly, it's written in 1955, but it's still the best book out there. And you really ought to read it. It's got some great stories. And I invariably, when I meet people, you know, during my presentations, now my grandfather shot the last one in Ventura. Well, the last one in California was seen in 1924 by Morro Rock in Sequoia National Park. Most reliable sighting. So getting into the plants, there's a lot of wonderful plants out there. There's manzanita, the one that we've talked about a lot here is ceanothus, chamise, scrub oak, mount mahogany, silk tassel bush, which is kind of rare and you don't see it much. Let's get to the big hot topic that everybody seems to be talking about sometimes, almost more than they ought to, and that's fire. What you're going to hear here is probably very different than what you've ever heard before. The key thing is to remember each ecosystem has its own fire regime. There's basically surface fires and crown fires. And what that means is in some forests, not all, actually not a lot of them, a lot of fires start and they burn in the understory and they don't kill the trees. That's mostly in the ponderosa pine forest in the Southwest, Arizona, New Mexico, not so much in California. But this is the thing that everybody thinks is the way forest fires are supposed to be. They're just supposed to be little fires, no trees get burned. And anytime a burn tree happens, they think it's horrible and it shouldn't have happened. Well, that's not true. There's crown fire regimes where the fire comes through and takes everything out. And that's what you see in chaparral. You also see it in a lot of forests. This is the Yellowstone Pine Forest, Yellowstone National Park Forest. These are all lodgepole pines. They have a natural fire return interval anywhere from 100 to 200 years, depending on elevation. This park got taken out by the fires back in, what's that sign say, 88, 89? It came back wonderfully. That's the way that fire should have been. That's the way it's supposed to be. People don't like big fires. They blame it on past fire suppression and unnatural vegetation buildup. Well, plants grow. That's sort of a natural thing. We just don't like fires. So we have come up with this weird story that isn't necessarily true. But this is the way fire operates for the most part. The thing to remember in chaparral, though, big, high intensity, low frequency fires once every 30 to 150 years. Again, large, low frequency, very high intensity, very hot fires, and they usually burn all the way to the beach or whatever the case may be. The biggest fire in San Diego County that's been recorded, estimated anyway, was in 1889. That was the Santiago Canyon fire. Took out Cuyamaca all the way down to the dirt, all the way up to Orange County and maybe parts of Riverside County, much bigger than the Cedar Fire, 1889. So this is long before all of this supposed fire suppression stuff happened. In chaparral, what we do know is fire suppression, putting out fires, has saved chaparral from too much fire. So what's the chaparral's relationship to fire? Well, this is behind my house, and this was after the Witch Creek fire in 2007. That's my son, he re-sprouted. Let's go back, we can see it again. You ready? Okay, this is the way post-chaparral fire landscapes should look. And it's important to realize that's not a disaster. It hasn't sterilized the soils. It hasn't created, you know, devastation anywhere in the ecosystem. This is the way it's supposed to be. The devastation happens when homes get burned. The problem is We're having too many fires now, and too many fires means no chaparral. And this picture is actually at the museum, at the Naturalist Museum. The whole thing got burned in 1970 in Laguna Fire. The middle section got burned in 1970 and 2001 in the Viejas Fire. And this lower section down here got burned in the Cedar Fire, 2003. You'll see what's happening there. It's all coming back as weeds. Between 2001, 2003, not enough time for the system to recover. And so it converts to weeds. And so the key point here is fires occurring less than 15 to 20 years apart leads to all sorts of horrible things. Reduced biodiversity, weedy grasslands, increased fire risk, the whole ball of wax. Grasses are more flammable than chaparral. And you'll probably interact with, because I do it almost on a weekly basis, somebody's going to tell you, well, didn't the Native Americans burn every 10 years? Well, if they did, there would be no chaparral left. We don't know what they did. We do know they used fire, but there's sort of a urban myth that ties into a lot of different issues here that sort of hoist this idea that Native Americans were burning all over the place and they never had big fires. And that just isn't true. They've always been big fires. They've always been hot. Some of them have been intense, some of them not. The difference is there's just too many people on the landscape now lighting too many fires. So this is the important key component. And you see this type of conversion in a lot of places, especially emission trails. You see this out in East County a lot. We've lost a lot of shrublands because there's just too many fires, too short a time apart, and the chaparral can't recover. And this is a picture of the Cleveland National Forest. All the hot colors there show you areas that have more fire than the system can tolerate. As you can see, the National Forest is in trouble. And the same pattern is repeating for all of Southern California. And honestly, this map is a little out of date because now Southern California has moved north and they're starting to get the fires we've had for the last 30 years. And they don't understand what's going on. It's pretty simple. The landscape's getting drier and it's getting drier because of human-caused climate change. And that's why the fires are burning hotter and faster and more frequently. It has nothing to do with past fire suppression and the horrible vegetation that has grown up because we put out fires. You get a dry landscape and it's going to burn, whether it's grass, shrubs, trees, or houses. And that's the thing you need to remember. So it's best to think of chaparrals adapted to particular fire patterns. There's a whole bunch of wonderful stories about how plants adjust to chaparral fires. The one there on the left, obligate cedars, those are the ones that the adult plant dies, and there's plants, there's seeds in the soil, and they either get stimulated by the heat or the charred wood chemicals that are in the remaining substances, or even from the smoke. And it's really neat. The ceanotha seeds, they have a little pore that gets opened up when the seed is heated. And guess what that allows to get into the seed? Water. other than that, they wouldn't germinate, you see. So they lay in the seed, in the soil seed bank for decades, century or more. And they're just hanging out, but they won't germinate unless they've been heated. Manzanita and almost all the post-fire flowers you see, they're stimulated by chemicals in the smoke or the charred wood. We're not exactly sure what's going on there, but that's how they respond. Now, you got to be careful. People say, well, chaparral needs fire then, doesn't it? Well, no, the plants are fine. It's making a statement like that is no different than saying you need to have your house burned out every 30 years because you have fire insurance. Why do you have fire insurance? So you can rebuild and restore yourself back to the original. That's why chaparral have these fire adaptations. They don't need to burn. They're not sitting there screaming, burn me, burn me. The fire is going to come, be it 30 years or 150 years. And when it comes, the system's ready. So you got to be careful with that nuance when you talk about fire and chaparral. And the problem now, though, is we have more fires than the system can tolerate. So we need to reduce the number of fires at a minimum. There's obligate resprouters, and those are the plants that just resprout. Those are things like scrub oak, hollow leaf cherry. All these plants basically have big seeds. So any plant with a big seed usually is an obligate resprouter. So the seeds all get burned up in the fire. The plant, the adult plant, doesn't die. it just resprouts. Then we have the confused guys here, the facultative seeders. They're the ones that resprout and they seed after fire. This is chamise. And you can see the little seedlings there and the resprouting parent. So the plant doesn't die, but the seedlings come up. Interestingly enough, that area that I showed you in that three burn slide, we've done some research down there in the chamise in the thrice burned area. They've gotten pretty hammered. So even though they've got sort of a backup by resprouting because they didn't have enough time to produce seeds to seed after that 2 year span, right? But they don't have enough starch in their underground burl from that 2 year span from the sun doing photosynthesis, right? To be able to recover after 2 years. So most of the chamise shrubs down there are gone too. And that's why the grasses are taking over. Then there's all sorts of lichens and geophytes. Those are geo means earth, phyte means plant. You've seen all of these wonderful displays after fires. It's just amazing. And the seeds will drop and they'll stay in the soil for 150 years and they'll be fine until the next fire. So I want to leave you with this thought and then we can maybe open it up for a couple minutes of questions, especially on the fire stuff. How can we enhance our lives through nature? And this is the key component that you want to leave people with. And always leave them with a good message at the end. Don't just sort of say bye. You know, ask them a question or two. And remember these three things. We want to get people outside more. And we want to know that they know they're outside because it's good for them. And they have to breathe, touch, smell, hear, because it feels good. And why does it feel good? Because this is where we came from. We've lived there for millions of years. And what we're doing now is just really weird. We're uncomfortable. We're stressed. We're tense. Go back home into the wilderness, into the wilds, the trail, anywhere in San Diego County that's away from noise. And you kind of start reconnecting with who you really are, your inner ancestral self. There's a great word called atavistic. It's a great word. And it's talking about atavistic traits. And those are traits and things you have in your, at some point, collective subconscious that are instinctual. And you feel it most readily, most easily when you're sitting watching a fire and you watch people around a fire. And it's a wonderful thing. They get hypnotized because that was the thing that separated us and gave us a selective advantage for all the other humans that didn't like fire. And that's hardwired into our system. That's an atavistic trait, that attraction to fire. Because what happens around a fire? Conversation. That means language. That means all sorts of things. And that dog that you have at your house, and he's sitting by the fire, that's a picture from a million years ago with that wolf right next to you. So that's why it feels good. And that means connecting to the outside. And then also you want to engage, right? And get people to connect with what they're really sensing with the environment and engaging. Just ask lots of questions and try to get people to enjoy what they're experiencing. So this is one of my favorite quotes from Carl Jung. Nature is an incomparable guide if you know how to follow her. So with that note, I hope you continue your program and learn how to follow nature in a more exciting way every time you go out. Thank you. To think about all of this.